Christians, Buddhists actually stayed back in what was then East Bengal, then renamed East Pakistan, so that East Pakistan would be a block as West Pakistan, and ultimately became Bangladesh. Also, there was an interesting fact. Many people who stayed back in East Pakistan were actually the scheduled caste Hindus, what were called then the depressed classes. There was also an internal issue between the Hindus, and these people felt that if the caste Hindus, what we call the upper caste Hindus, migrate to now New India, at least they will be liberated. And scheduled caste Hindus felt that, chalo, now we will be finally having the position of dominance and influence in the new Pakistan. And as you know, the scheduled caste Hindu was made the first law minister of Pakistan.
Mandal,
yes. Mr. Mandal, and then he defected within a year and 3 years, he realized what was happening over there, that even the scheduled caste Hindus in Pakistan were not given the freedom, were not given the promise of Qaid-e-Azam that now in Pakistan everyone is saying there are no Hindus and there are no Muslims. Now, why this is important is that it made the entire process of citizenship a big problem. Because now, two things are happening. The two new nations were developing. You had India developing a constitution, and the Constituent Assembly developing a constitution. And of course, you had Pakistan, which also had a history of trying to develop a constitution, which was also not developed until the Nehru-Liaquat Pact. They were still functioning on the objective resolutions which had been passed by the Muslim League through the Pakistan Constituent Assembly. Now, in the citizenship, therefore, it had an imprint, this whole thing, had an imprint on the process of the drafting of our constitution and coming up with the citizenship. How? Now, the constitution actually put an entire chapter on citizens. There were 7 articles to deal with citizens. Article 5, which said that who are the citizens of India? A, who are born in the territory of India, or either whose parents were born in the territory of India, or who are ordinarily resident in India not less than 5 years. Okay? Territory of India means India as per the Government of India Act 1935. So it would include Peshawar, it would include Dilip Kumar, who may have been born in now Pakistan but was staying in Bombay. Article 6 now dealt with the reality of partition. Article 6 said that it would also confer citizenship to those who migrated from the territory of India, which was now Pakistan, to now what is India. Article 7 again dealt with the reverse situation. What about those Muslims and others who left India and went to Pakistan and very soon realized, Manto couldn't come back. But many of the Muslims who actually went to Pakistan came back because they realized that this is not the promise which was given to us. Like Dominic Lapierre writes that one vegetable seller in Bengal was asked, why do you support Pakistan? She said that I was told that the prices of vegetables will be less when Pakistan is made. So these are the kinds of things which led people to believe that they will have freedom. They did not get freedom, so they came back. So Article 7 says that if you come back by March 1947, it says that people who come back by 19 July 1948 will be given the citizenship of India. Article 8 also gave the, please tell me if my time is, now because a lawyer with a captive audience just goes. So Article 8 also deals with people whose grandparents were resident of the Government of India Act, India. Article 9 then deals with people who voluntarily acquire Indian citizenship. Article 10 talks about the acquisition of citizenship through law and the right of Parliament to pass a law. Article 11 also deals with it. Now also, the constitution made it very clear that it will be a law which will decide and govern citizenship, and you are aware that ultimately you have the Citizenship Act 1955, which we are still trying to amend in the 2019, which governs the entire legal regime of citizenship. The constitution also dealt with the issue of what rights will citizens have, and will non-citizens, stateless people are non-citizens, what rights will non-citizens have? So certain articles, like Article 14, the right to equality, Article 20, right against double jeopardy, 21 right to life, 22 against protection against illegal detention, 23 Vega, etc. are applicable to everyone, to stateless people, non-citizens and citizens. Whereas certain rights, as you know, like public employment and college admission, 15, 16, 19, the right to freedom of speech and expression, all these are only, right to freedom of religion, are only applicable and only available to citizens. Now, the Citizenship Act 1955, before we come to the Citizenship Act, I will quickly in two, three minutes deal with the developments which happened between the 1950 when we made the Constitution and 1955, what happened. Now, this is very significant because I had started by saying that the migration patterns in Pakistan and migration patterns in India are different. Also, keep in mind the unique history of the subcontinent. Here I will talk also about the Chit Mahals. Have you heard about the Chit Mahal? The Indian-Bangladesh corridors, how many have heard of Chit Mahals? Show of hands, then I'll, if you have not heard, then I'll explain a little detail, otherwise I'll explain. Two zamindars or kings are playing chess, pasha in Bengali. Whoever wins says, okay, ye dao tu le le, tu rakh le. The Raja of Kuchbihar and the Raja of Rajshahi. As a result, what happens? Every time, and if they are too drunk, they won't remember, but if they remember, one day he has won one enclave, one day he has won one enclave. As a result, Raja of Kuchbihar has several small villages in Rajshahi. And Raja of Rajshahi has several small villages in Kuchbihar. No one thought that one day Rajshahi will be in East Pakistan and Kuchbihar will be in Bengal, in India. So that is how you had these pockets of India and Bengal, Pakistan in India. This was a problem more in the eastern sector than the western sector. Western sector, the border, this was very important. Western sector, the border was hostile, like you had the Rud of Kutch, you had the Thar Desert. The border in the eastern sector between India and Bangladesh was very porous, was very artificial, because again, as I said, Radcliffe just sat in Calcutta and Delhi and made this border. And there was hardly any kind of border patrol. And in those days, you remember, of course, I was too young, maybe I was not born then, there were trains like the Farak Express and all, which actually used to travel from one part of India to another through Bangladesh, then East Pakistan. So that was the fluidity over there. Now, what happened is that because a substantial number, around 29% of the minorities, stayed back in East Pakistan, and slowly the hardened faction of the Muslim League government in Pakistan was taking over. As I said, Mandal was forced to leave. Was forced to leave. The program started of going against the minorities. It was a state-sponsored program, and there were several instances of looting, arson, rape, and the minorities again started immigrating from, or rather fleeing from, East Pakistan into Assam, into Bengal, into Tripura.
Islamization.
Whatever. Islamization, yes, you can say by 1950 it was Islamization. So much so that they said that Rabindra Sangeet sounds very Hindu. So therefore, Rabindra Sangeet was banned by all India, Pakistan radio, whatever. And yes, Bengali language was also, they said that Bengali language has certain Hindu tainted words and they have to be removed. So yes, this kind of program started. Now, as a result, what happened was the Nehru-Liaquat Pact happened. It reached positions where there was large-scale retaliatory violence in Bihar and Bengal. People were angry. Prime Minister Nehru was under pressure. And ultimately, Liaquat Ali Khan came and they sat for 6 days, and ultimately the Nehru-Liaquat Pact was entered into on 8th of April 1950. The key features of this pact are that both governments agreed that they have to take measures to permit free movement of the minorities from one part to the other. They will be allowed to bring in certain allowance. There will be certain measures taken to calm. Ministers will jointly go and try to calm, etc. Now, this Nehru-Liaquat Pact was very controversial. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, who was then the minister in the Nehru cabinet, resigned on this very particular fact. Why? He said that you are bringing about a parity between India and Pakistan. Because this kind of genocide, this kind of program was not happening against the Indian minorities. Because by that time, India had stabilized. The constitution was almost in place. It was in place actually, 26 January 1950. And this fact is happening in April 1950. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee also said that already you had two agreements, nothing has happened. He also said that this particular agreement that you are saying, not only are you making India and Pakistan the same, you have not provided for any kind of damages, any kind of compensation. So ultimately, this pact is not going to prevent violence from ending. And that is exactly what happened. The violence continued thereafter. Ultimately, so far as the subsequent developments are concerned, you are aware that we had wars between India and Pakistan, and during this entire time, the statelessness continued. There was vast immigration of population into Assam. Now, coming back, I will not deal with in detail about the Assam Pact. Let me say that in this time already there were certain cases being fought.